Hey, 99ers, welcome to Reading Recap 1. Information in the reading that I have assigned is going to be very important for participating in the activities that we're going to have in class. So my goal this quarter is to walk you through some of the readings so you can understand what are the most important points for you to focus on. So I have printed out, get this to focus, my reading guide, or essentially the assigned reading that we're going to be using for the first 5 weeks of this course. I also have a copy of my physical textbook. Yes, I'm old school. I use a physical textbook. That is okay. So let's go ahead and get started. Let's break it down. Looking at page 46 to 49. 46 basically starts off with the central dogma, talks about the information flow of genetic, basically information. So the things that are most important is, first of all, on page 46, you see that in bold, there's complementary and base pairs. These are two very important terms for you to learn. Understand complementary. Understand what a base pair is. The second thing that I want you to focus on as you go through the reading is going to be what we call the central dogma, direction of flows of information. So we go from DNA to RNA to protein. I'm gonna say it again. DNA to RNA to protein. So the process of going from DNA to RNA is called transcription, and then going from RNA to protein is translation. We're going to focus mostly on DNA and self-replication on the first 5 weeks. The next 2 weeks with Dr. Inlay, you'll be focusing on transcription and translation. So essentially, just know that the current dogma, or what we call the central dogma of molecular biology, is that DNA is what holds all of our genetic information. DNA also copies itself. DNA can be transcription, right, into RNA, then RNA gets translated into protein. You'll see that there's actual details about some of the molecules that are involved with RNA transcription and translation of protein. You won't be going into detail in these processes right now for weeks 1 through 5, but you will revisit these processes and the different types of RNAs in weeks 6 through 10. So you'll also see as you go along that on these pages, there are different types of RNA. I would like you to know the definitions of these different types of RNA, and then know for the purposes of this course that mRNA or messenger RNA is the one that codes for actual proteins that are going to be made. The other RNAs are essential for a lot of different types of jobs and actually make up majority of the RNA compared to the messenger RNA. But remember, for this class, the mRNA is going to be very, very important, especially for weeks 1 through 5. Okay, so now we are going to move on to, let's see, page 62 to 64. Okay, so 62 to 64 basically begins with the chemical properties that allow us to understand how genetic information is actually stored and used. So we're trying to take some of the information that we learned from biochemistry and apply that to genetics, which I think you took in fall. So we're kind of merging the fields together now. So first off, the structure of DNA and RNA, I want you to know this like the back of your hand, right? It's broken into three main pieces. You have a phosphate, you have a 5-ring sugar or pentose, and then you have what we call a base. And a base is called a base because like by itself in water, it's slightly basic. That's why it's called a base. I need you to know all different types of bases that there are. And then I also need you to know the difference between DNA and RNA. So these should be very, very straightforward concepts that you can get from the reading that you can analyze. So for example, you have thymine T, adenine A, guanine G, cytosine Z. You also have uracil U. And I think what will be really, really helpful is if you turn to page 64, there is a table of the nomenclature. This is a good table for you to learn. And in that table, I would focus on knowing the name of the base, the one letter code for the base, the difference between a nucleoside and a nucleotide. I always say that a nucleoside is basically just missing a Okay. So a nucleoside is just missing the phosphate group. So if you say phosphate, step aside, that's a nucleoside. Okay, cool. So difference between nucleoside, nucleotide. The difference between DNA and RNA. I'm going to say this in several places, not just this video. But what defines DNA versus RNA is going to be the 2' position. Let me see if I can show you this really quickly. Light. There we go. The 2' position. You see where that H or hydrogen is in red, that's a hydroxyl group. And you have an OH in red, H, OH in red. Okay, yes. This 2' position is what is the actual difference between DNA and RNA. So remember, RNA is called ribonucleic acid. DNA is deoxyribonucleic acid. Oh my gosh, look at my nails. They look so janky and bad. I'll fix that for class. Okay, so deoxy means it has one less oxygen at the 2' position. So you see that difference, yes? Okay, yes. You will learn as we go through class that there are several bases that are usually associated with DNA, bases normally associated with RNA. One that trips up students a lot is uracil. Uracil is normally with RNA. But uracil can also be incorporated into DNA. And what makes DNA DNA is the fact that it has that lack of oxygen at that 2' position. So remember, deoxy. The information is in the name. Don't get tripped up. You will have questions on this. And hopefully nobody will miss it because I'm trying to emphasize it. Okay, so we just got through page 62 to 64. Let's move to page 173 to 178. Okay, so 173 has this really cool story about a moment of discovery. There's not information here that you necessarily need to know, but it's really enjoyable and cool just to see how exciting it is to be on the forefront of discovery. Okay, as we turn the page, we're on to 174. We basically learn about how the structure of DNA was discovered through Watson and Crick, basically, you know, hijacking and stealing Rosalind Franklin's data, you know, be like that sometimes. But from their hypothesizing, we were able to understand basically the structure of DNA and what it looks like. So on page 175, I want to point out some more of the details about understanding what the bases are. So it can be categorized in 2 groups. You have purine and pyrimidines. I like to say the purine is the shorter word, is a bigger molecule. Pyrimidines, the bigger word, is the smaller molecules. But these are heterocyclic compounds. And a heterocyclic compound essentially is something that it has one or more ring structures and it has 2 different elements. So hetero, different, cyclic, you know, a circle. Now, as I already mentioned, that bases are weakly basic, and that's why they are named these. These bases are what's going to be so important for how information is stored and transferred in our DNA. So know which bases each base pairs with. So usually you have a purine with a pyrimidine. And basically, that's how that goes. Let's see, anything else I want to point out? I already talked about how uracil can be in DNA and the difference between RNA and DNA. The information about the different Pucker positions and structure based off of this D2 endo is not necessarily important for this course, but it's kind of a really cool fun fact. Okay. The next thing we want to talk about as we go through this couple of pages, maybe we focus on, is that phosphodiester bond. And this is the bond that joins nucleotides together. And because you lose water, you know, there's residual that we end up calling these residues. And so it's kind of cool to know where some of these names come from. Let's see. On page 178, there's a key convention box. And in general, as you're reading, if you see these key convention boxes, pay attention to them. It's really important information. A key convention box talking about the polarity of DNA RNA chains and how we have nomenclature. So 5' to 3' is the direction in which we always write DNA or RNA, no matter what side of the DNA strand that is on. Know this. This will come up in class multiple times, multiple different types of questions over and over again. The 5' end of a DNA or RNA is defined by the free phosphate group. So where's the phosphate group that's not attached to anything? That's the 5' end. And then to look for the 3' end, that's going to be the oxygen that's not attached to anything. So 5', free phosphate, and then the 3', you're looking for the hydroxyl group. That's just out there, that OH group. And then so another thing to point out is that when they're all hooked together and these phosphodiesters their bonds, they end up get this negatively charged backbone. And that's also going to be something that's important. So at pH 7, DNA or these backbones of RNA are usually negatively charged. The last, another concept I do want to point out is about stability between RNA and DNA. Know which one is more or less stable and know why. So for example, RNA gets hydrolyzed because of that, the 2' OH. So it can easily be hydrolyzed in basic conditions, what we call alkaline conditions, and then also ribonucleases can easily like cut it up, which makes DNA just much more stable and why we can find DNA from really, really old samples and things like that. I do also want to point out, if you get to page 179, about base pairing. So that base pairing, the interaction that really holds them together are hydrophobic bonds. And then we'll talk about which ones have the strongest interactions based off the number of hydrogen bonds that they make. Okay, cool. And I just want to double check. So I think I might have misspoken. No, we're good. We're good. Let's see. Where are we? Okay, so now we got to go to page 43 to 45. 43 to 45. Okay, cool. So 43 to 45 basically talks about the foundations of molecular genetics and how we know that DNA is actually the carrier of genetic information and not RNA and not protein. And I do want you to understand this concept of how we logically figured out that DNA has to be it. So in figure 222, there's an experiment about a virulent strain or non-virulent strain of different bacteria, and then like breaking up into different pieces and then injecting into a mouse to figure out if the mouse dies or lives. We're gonna go over some example problems of these, but take time reading this experiment and this figure, understand what is going on in this figure, and you will get example problems both in on your homework and discussion, and you will see a problem about this on the exam. So focus on that. Okay, the next page is 45. 45 is going to be really important. We're going to use oxytropes a lot in the next couple weeks. Know what an oxytrope is, a particular mutant. The best way to clearly understand what an oxytrope is to go over the experimental workflow that you see on page 46. So this figure, and so it's figure 223, it really lays out how they're able to test whether or not you have a single mutation in a gene that codes for an enzyme. So take time, go through that figure, annotate it, mark it, make sure you understand it. If you don't understand it, come with questions, post them on the discussion board, ask the questions during discussion section, or come to office hours to make sure you get this clear in your mind. And the last thing for reading recap number one, it's going to be page 57 and then 178, 179. Page 57, 57. Okay. Page 57. This is Hersey and Chase experiments. This is also another very, very important experiment that it would behoove you to ensure that you learn it and you understand it and you understand why every single portion of material or reagent used in these experiments was used. We will, of course, again, walk through it in class tomorrow, but please, 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 please take notes on this, review this, make sure you understand the core concepts of every step done. If something in this experiment does not make sense to you, make a note of it. Ask someone, ask your friends, ask the TAs, ask the LAs, come to office hours. Make sure you are clear on this Hersey and Chase experiment. This is a core concept that I want you to know. And then 178, 179. So basically, I went over this already. But since we're back here, basically on the second page, I'm talking about the absorption of UV light by DNA. So one thing you'll note is that the resonance or the localization of electrons in these ring structures actually allows nucleotides to absorb UV light in a certain range, and this is 260 nanometers. No 260 nanometers, you will recognize that. Say if you have a graph and you see 260 nanometers and you see absorbance there, that's going to mean it's DNA or RNA. And then the amount that DNA or RNA can actually absorb in the UV range is going to depend on whether it's single-stranded DNA, single-stranded RNA, how collapsed they are. So just know that the UV this spectra can actually change depending on the content of different nucleosides and whether or not it's DNA or an RNA. And so we'll probably touch on this and we'll have some exam questions, but the most important point, the thing for you to know, is that it can absorb at 260 nanometers. Okay, so I think that's it for today. Hopefully this helps you a little bit with your reading and disseminating or just distilling down what's important to focus on. So this combined with the reading quizzes, I'm excited to get to work tomorrow. All right, I'll see ya.